Do you want to cover your next topic also?
Yeah, I'll finish.
He is going to speak also on a very interesting topic, nanophthalmics and SICS. So he's going to deliver two talks.
As I said earlier, if you control the astigmatism, if you know how to, as Dr. Boramani said, how to control it, I control it by not stretching the tunnel. That's number one. At no point of time I'll be stretching the tunnel, so it has to go back. And in my tunnel, I don't extend laterally. The anterior end of the tunnel is also 6 millimeter, like the posterior tunnel. We have done maybe 5,000 to 6,000 analysis of our, even more of astigmatism, surgeon-induced astigmatism. I know exactly how much astigmatism I'll be producing. This is the beautiful modified hydrodissection cannula that I made, which you can just go under the capsule. With a very controlled flow, you can push the this thing. I know that this surgery will produce zero astigmatism. I'm sure about it. And I always bisect the nucleus with the, there's a single tunnel, there's no side port. Bisect it with the cannula, shaft of the cannula, in all soft cataracts. And I'm injecting viscoelastic continuously. And then at the end of it, I've got a good rexis, and the patient wanted a multifocal lens. You can go and put a multifocal lens. So what is important in a multifocal lens is not that you're putting it into the capsular bag. You should center it to the visual axis. Ask the patient to look at the source of the light and adjust the lens position. See, wherever you want, it stays there. Probably it stays there postoperatively also. You can push it in a direction in such a way, rotate it if you want, in such a way that the Purkinje, now it's not centered because one is folded, slightly pushed to the other side. Keep forming the chamber. When you form the chamber, ultimately the center of the first ring should correspond to the Purkinje 1 image. If you have achieved that, the patient, see, look at this. So that is the target that you have in multifocal lens. So similarly, an EDF multifocal lens, as I said, so let us just run through it. And I do not fold. The biggest advantage I have is I do not have to squeeze it through a small tunnel. Personally, these lenses are made with such fine crafting, such fine equipment. These are 0.2, 0.3 micron things. If you put it like this, the quality of the lens is going to be perfect. Imagine you're going to fold it and squeeze it. It's like you have a nicely ironed shirt, push it through a small tube and then wear it. It's all folded. So you will not have lens-induced higher order aberrations when you follow this technique. So I enjoy doing trifocals. That's a trifocal lens, which is beautiful rexis that's placed inside that. And you position this and they will have wonderful vision. There's no need to bandage. Immediately, soon after surgery, they start enjoying the vision. I have developed a small degree gauge. And all the toric lenses that we have today are, you have the toric markers, which are huge. All the markings are, as I said, I've got half a dozen of them. And they all have marks on the inside portion. So you'll have to, some of them have at 90 degrees, some of them, the handles are at 180 degrees. There's no uniformity in them. And again, when you want to mark any incision on the cornea for astigmatic purposes, the Purkinje image should be centered to the marks, centered to the ring, which is impossible. It's so far away. You will not be ensuring that it's in the center. So what can we do? With the help of Epsilon, I have developed a smaller set. That's the stages of development. And this is too long. Then I asked him to make it shorter so it doesn't, there's a drawings that I sent. And all the markings are on the peripheral side, not on the central side. And the angulation is also quite steep so that the brow or the eyelid margin or the lid will not touch. The other thing we have done is the handle is at 30 degrees. It's at 30 degrees, not at 0 degree. So it will spare the horizontal as well as vertical meridians for that. So I've, along with the cataract surgery here, I've done the limbal relaxing incision. The way I point is exactly at 0 degrees, I touch the tip of it with the trepan blue dipped 27 gauge cannula. That's a very fine cannula. You can see it makes a mark like the one there. So you know exactly what degree you'll have to adjust. And here I'm doing a LRI with a diamond knife. Depth is 80 to 90% of the corneal thickness there. So the way to do is, I have two points there, one point there and one point there. If it's going away, then you can actually touch with the tip of a needle, but tip of the cannula is good enough. So I start at about a millimeter inside the limbus, go vertically down, stop there. Don't start doing it there. Stop there for some time, take a breath, and then holding the breath, you just move the blade up to that end. You can see the other end. So this will correct about 1.25 as you have planned before of the astigmatism that you have. This is a very elegant technique. Toric lens could not be implanted on this patient because it's a very high myopic. Toric lens were not available, and patient wanted very good vision. That is the degree caliper that I've introduced. There are many advantages in that. So toric lenses are the other option that you have. You've got a perfect rexus. Hydrodissection, I'll quickly run through it. You have to make a capsular separating hydrodissection and never inject in front of the capsular bag, in front of the anterior capsule, because the fluid finds its way through the zonules into the vitreous cavity, increasing the pressure. Even if you have pushed half a drop of fluid through the zonules into the vitreous cavity, imagine any point of time you have an intraoperative hard eye, that means just before that you've injected some fluid through the zonules into the vitreous cavity. Otherwise, it can never happen. It's all intraoperative hard eyes are iatrogenic. You have induced them, and that can be avoided by avoiding injection through the zonules into it. So you can position the toric lens, I'll run through it quickly, and position it and ensure that the axis is correct to the axis that you have made. And here, because there is no ring, you cannot ascertain that it's exactly fixed to the Purkinje I image. And astigmatism, you can make it 0, you can make it 0.2, 0.4, depending upon what you do with the tunnel and where you situate. Always I close my conjunctiva tenons with the fibrin glue so that there is no exposed wound at the end of it. This is the finest surgery you can do. If I have done a phaco, there are 3 openings at the limbus, which is detrimental. I'll go on to the next presentation. Can I have mine again? This one? Yeah, sure. Sorry, I closed. Third. No. This is a surgery which ideally worked for about 3 months before performing. A young lady, 27, 28-year-old lady. She came with bilateral non-ophthalmos. Pressures were very high. We did an iridectomy to combat the glaucoma that they're all prone for. So I've done under topical anesthesia. The patient was extremely cooperative. She had no pain. This is a tunnel floor entry, is a savior here. Otherwise, it's impossible to do the surgery. I was ready to do the scleral pockets if necessary, because intraoperative hard eye is known in these patients. I could achieve to do a very good rexus in this eye. The corneal diameter is just about 10 millimeter, probably less than 10 millimeters. It's a very small eye. And then I could get a good rexus. It didn't run off. It didn't run off just because I could adopt tunnel floor entry technique. And I had developed a special lens for her, which is 60 diopter in power. That's probably the first time a lens of power of 60 diopter was implanted in a human eye. I've searched the literature. And being a soft cataract, I could ask most of it, I could churn it and aspirate it with 2 instruments. And there is no positive pressure at all during the surgery. That's an attribute to the no injection technique, because I didn't inject anything into the orbit. There was no positive pressure there. That's the lens which goes into the capsular bag. That's a PMMA lens. And I went to the IOL lab and sat with the technician there and developed this lens. It was possible. Initially, it was a trial and error. Ultimately, we could develop a couple of lenses of 60 diopters, which I implanted in her in both the eyes. PMMA lens is a little tricky to push it into the capsular bag in a small eye like this. And ultimately, I could achieve it. No sutures. Astigmatism in this patient was 0. And I'll show you the K readings. The tunnel is closed. There is no bandage. You couldn't imagine. This patient was wearing plus 20 contact lens and varying correcting lenses, correcting spectacles in the top of it. And that's a PI which was done before. And that's, she had 6-9 vision, which she has never seen in her life. So that's the lens which you saw. It's a diameter of 5.5, and overall diameter instead of 13.5 is only 11.5. It's a small size lens that was again made in India. It's, this is an unsterile lens. I had a couple of lenses, and that's the lens. It's extremely fat, as you can see the profile. Short eyes, less than 20.5 millimeter, can have a normal anterior segment or a normal posterior segment, or both can be abnormal. Non-ophthalmos or simple micro-ophthalmos, the entire eye is normal, abnormal. It's shorter. And they are prone for choroidal detachments, and you should be ready with the concept of opening the sclera so that the pressure is let out. They are prone for glaucoma, and the 2 to 4 millimeter full, 2 to 4 of them, full thickness sclerotomies, sometimes we plan earlier. Nowadays I've done half a dozen of these patients bilaterally. None of them have positive pressure. So there is something which you are missing out in its management. She is a consanguineous product, and that's the vision she had. Her best corrected vision with pinhole was 612, 612 preoperatively. And scopy on the lenses she was wearing grossly undercorrected lenses. That's a pentacam picture of her. And she was wearing all kinds of lenses. She joined with great difficulty in IT industry, and she was working on that. So her axial lens was 16 in the right eye and 15.98 in the left eye, and no intraocular lens formulas can give straight away the power to correct that. And we used all the formulas I thought of it, and the best would be, as per the chart, Hyagis, but Hyagis gave off results. We use Barrett Universal 2. It has a limit of 16.5. So I projected, extrapolated it to 16, and it's 1 millimeter of axial length change. In that 16 millimeter axial length means 9 diopter changes. So 1 millimeter change normally gives 3 diopters. Here it gives 3 times that power. So I incorporated into the formula. It came to 58.5, and I wanted to make it slightly myopic, so I implanted a 60 diopter lens. So going back retrospectively, looking at the results of all my surgeries, Hoffer Q is the best for short eyes. There's nothing better than Hoffer Q or Barrett's Universal, which is extrapolated. So these are the two you should use for a short eye. And that's a PM, that's a special lens that we made. Commercially, it's not available. And there's very little working place. Avoid periocular injections. That's the one which reduces the size of the globe, pushes it from behind. I use topical intracameral, repeated dispersive visco infusion protect the endothelium. Sclereal windows were not necessary in any of my 12 eyes. And surgery and post-operative recovery was blemishless. 2 eyes were operated at 14 days spots. That's a patient who's really enjoying her vision. Friends, in India, we have everything that's available to us. We are blessed people. And if you want to do any special help for a special patient, you can go out of the way to see that they're very comfortable. Pressures have been normal throughout. Even on the day one, pressures were normal. So with that, I would like to introduce something which is unique and which was done in India by us, that is implanting a 60 diopter one-piece lens, which is never seen in the ophthalmic literature. Thank you.